This is a story of the very far future. Imagine thousands of years ahead of where we are now. The world would be as unrecognizable to you as our world would be to a random human transported from the days of Charlemagne to the present. We talk about things like the technological singularity, where we sit upon the precipice of the incomprehensible, where our technological development could snowball like an avalanche down a mountain and overwhelm us, moving so rapidly that we can't really even understand it. We must simply go with the flow as AI begins to dictate the invention and implementation of new technologies. I don't think it will quite play out that way, but there are those that do. But imagine that future, regardless of where you think technology will lead us. In doing so, you must think in the sense of what you know is possible, or at least plausible, because you can't know the unknowable. You can entertain ideas such as unknown, undiscovered physics, where faster-than-light travel becomes possible, and also time travel. When you do that, though, paradoxes appear, and abound, until you ultimately conclude that if such things were happening in the future, we'd know about it and see time travelers all around us, and not just human ones, but alien time travelers as well. And given the collective time the universe has been able to support life, billions of years, we'd see a lot of them, especially in light that most alien civilizations that will ever exist in the universe lie in its future rather than its past. Seeing such a traveler, if it were possible, would be as ubiquitous as watching someone go through a huge line in a drive-thru just to desperately purchase some tacos. Since we do not see aliens lining up for a burger and fries, we can safely assume that our idea that nature prohibits such travel is either correct, or such travelers are unbelievably subtle and have no taste for Kentucky-linked fried foods, constructed with some unholy secretive mix of multiple herbs and spices. But such things are what is in store for the universe at large as humanity flexes its wings and brings order to the chaos through colonization of the Milky Way galaxy. The lesson of the fast food drive-thru is that we as humans seek and will put great effort into finding what we're looking for. It's in our nature, whether we're combing the internet in hopes of finding that vintage Star Wars figure of that weird creature that sat on Jabba the Hutt's tail cackling maniacally at his every utterance. My ultimate fate, should aliens ever invade, I for one welcome our new alien overlords, as it were. Or searching the cosmos as best we can for any signs of life, and attempt to understand the natural world around us. Fast forward. Should we survive our trials and tribulations as a technological species, will we push out into the cosmos to become at the very least a multiplanetary species, and very probably a multi-star system civilization or group of civilizations? But this may not unfold as you might imagine. Our standard view of galactic expansion is to hop in a multi-generational starship and traverse the expanse to get to the next star system. Many people would successively be born, live, and die all on that starship. We can do this with our current technology. The nearest star system is only about 4.5 light years away, meaning that we could hop in a starship at birth and be there in extreme old age. But that doesn't really make a lot of sense. Who wants to spend their entire lives in a hollowed-out asteroid starship when there are mountains to be climbed on Mars? Rather, we are more likely to send robots first, which aren't so sensitive to the passage of time. But there are instances where the distances shrink, such as when star systems pass within a light year of Earth, as has happened many hundreds, if not thousands, of times in the past. Imagine a long-distant past encounter where another star system passed within close proximity, even within the Oort cloud, gracing our skies with a bright star. A second sun, not totally unlike Tatooine, but not bound to the sun gravitationally and far more distant and dimmer, but could conceivably cast shadows at night if it were a large enough star, or not be visible at all without a telescope if it were a tiny red dwarf. At that moment, had someone technological been around to see it, it would have been an opportunity for easy colonization. Perhaps even necessary colonization, given that such a passing star system might very well perturb a hail of comets in the Oort cloud and send them careening our way, arriving any day now. And if that were happening today, and we found a passing star system with a habitable planet in close proximity, we would be going there, especially if that planet was better than Earth. Yes, it's possible for an exoplanet to be superior than Earth in certain circumstances, especially if you can terraform. But that's all down to luck, and our luck is that we happen to appear on this world when a close stellar encounter isn't occurring. But if we'd had different luck, our global priorities and how history is unfolding might be very different, in the same way as the discovery of the Americas was in the past. A new world, literally, would be in our hands. And in the future, should we make it, this will come to pass. There will be a stellar encounter in our future that will make it viable for us to colonize another star system. Granted, this process takes millions of years. We have a long wait ahead of us. But it then becomes exponential. Once you colonize a second star system, then that system also undergoes stellar encounters of its own, and a third, fourth, fifth, hundredth, thousandth colonization occurs. Soon you've spread across the galaxy simply by a close encounter. Time defeats the distances of the galaxy for biological colonization. So long as we survive and persist, we will do this. But we may not do it in our present form. We are Homo sapiens, and we evolved and are adapted for this specific world. Off it, we get frail, as is shown by astronauts spending months in LEO on the International Space Station, having to spend considerable amounts of time readjusting to the conditions of Earth when they return from long missions. To explore space directly, we literally have to bring a bubble of Earth with us. We need oxygen, food, and even gravity to spend truly large amounts of time in space or on other worlds that have less, or for that matter, more gravity. High gravity is easily envisioned. Think of a world, a super Earth, with twice the gravity of Earth. Imagine how hard it would be to move around, how exhausting it would be, and how hard your heart would have to be pumping just to get blood to your brain. You might get muscular in such an environment, but it would be way harder than simply going to the gym. And that's only a super Earth, just a little larger than this one. Go much beyond two Earth masses, and it's frankly fatal. This means that the universe's most common types of planets, the gas giants, ice giants, and super Earths, are immediately fatal to us. Less so for smaller terrestrial planets. You can land on a lower gravity environment and walk around for a bit, as the Apollo astronauts did on the moon. But one mistake, one rip in the spacesuit, as it were, and it's curtains. So the question here is, does it have to be that way? Can we make a better human, more suited to the realities of space? The answer is yes. In principle, you can make a human that's streamlined, and can handle more or less gravity indefinitely, or more suitably function in deadly environments. You won't get past certain realities, such as the reactivity and suitability of oxygen as an energy source, but you can mitigate some of the bad effects of space. Another example here would be the realities of living on an O'Neill cylinder in artificial gravity, induced by the spinning of the cylinder through centrifugal force. One of the issues that's been pointed out with this is that while you would feel the effect of gravity, turning your head would cause vertigo at least. It may be that normal humans under those conditions can adapt and become used to it, but if not, you could redesign the inner ear or the brain to be suitable for it. Though going back to Earth and living in real gravity might then become the problem. This has been well explored in science fiction, such as in The Expanse, where humans bred in space and to some degree optimized for it have serious problems returning to Earth. There may come a point in the far future where there will be humans, ostensibly members of Homo sapiens, or if you will, Martians or Oberonians or Plutonians, if they were sufficiently adapted for the environments they were born in, might find Earth, their planet of distant origin, deadly to visit. They would have evolved, in this case artificially, to have progressed past their original evolutionary starting point. Or none of that will happen and we just stay home. It's one thing to dream of space colonization, but the reality of it is that it's so harsh that living on Earth just becomes an inevitability, and heading into space becomes the next century's equivalent of hopping on cruise ships, when the fares are low. Mars might be a nice place to visit, but you may not want to live there, especially if the local water disagrees with you. Actually, physically loading yourself onto a spacecraft bound for other star systems, in reality, may not be the best way to spread humanity throughout the galaxy to call it our own. There are several other hypothetical ways, but one very obvious one is through the use of a von Neumann probe. Say we built a probe that could replicate itself from local raw materials it finds in other star systems, all while moving at sublight, comfortable, doable speeds. Nothing crazy going on here as far as the laws of physics go, just a robotic probe that can repair itself and travel indefinitely and make copies of itself. The end result is that even at slow, sublight speeds, it will have entirely colonized the galaxy in under 10 million years, which is not really that much time. The dinosaurs proper have been dead over 6 times longer than that, though ever persists the birds. Can't live with them, can't live without them. Such a far future, highly technological probe needs only the genetic information of humans to print one of us out, and possibly even install within the memories and personality of someone long dead. It can be envisioned here that an entire civilization of natural humans, or augmented ones, could be created to specific exoplanet environments where they are encountered and found suitable for colonization. This brings us to technologically assisted panspermia, where nature itself isn't transporting and depositing life, though in principle it can, but technology doing so. But that actually may prove uninteresting and dangerous to a future humanity. If we send out copies of ourselves, we may run the risk of coming into contact with them as we directly colonize and conflict develops as we physically move out into the galaxy. It may be better to do it on a much smaller scale by sending out the genomes of tailored microbes. This is much simpler of a proposition, but an unbelievably powerful one. Make no mistake, life on this world, especially microbial life, has terraformed it. This planet would not have the huge oxygen levels it does without photosynthesis and a lot of time. But if you're in no hurry or have no other choice, you could send out advanced probes to populate suitable worlds with microbes that over time will transform them into something you can live on. That's if you're willing to wait. But through genetic engineering and planning on the part of your Cedar probe, you could cut the time down significantly from what it took Earth to reach us under natural conditions. Of course, we may go extinct before we get anywhere near this technology. It's at least centuries off. But it could eventually serve as a means where humanity could spread its genome, or its microbial life's genome, tailor them to promising exoplanets, and create artificial habitability where it may not have previously existed, and then take our time to travel to those worlds and colonize them, even by sitting around and waiting for stellar encounters. After all, if we do indeed survive our technological infancy, then we really do have trillions of years to burn in this universe. We are in fact here, very early in the universe's lifetime. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently contemplating the month of November. In the United States, where I originate, this is the month where we pick a day, which differs from Canada somehow, to gather up and collectively roast a large bird and then fall upon it and consume it. Amid much mirth and celebration, various pies, and occasionally family arguments over religion and politics, culminating with the watching of sporting events. Some would say that this behavior is why aliens don't contact us, but I counter with this. What if the first SETI message we receive is send more football and dance music? Not sure how I feel about that, but any message would be nice. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.